Okay. Thank you. Okay, welcome back from lunch. It's good to be here again. If I ate all this food, I'd be dead in about a month down here. We're not used to it. It's pretty good. All right, so I'm not sure what I was supposed to talk about. I mean, I kind of have an idea what I was supposed to talk about, but that's what I want to talk about. So that's what we're going to talk about. We'll try to try to stay focused on what is commonly called project studios. I have some things I want to share with you on that. All of this is going to be available on our website. I've got about a four-hour talk, which we, of course, won't have time for. And it'll also be there in about a week in the obvious place, or anybody wants to keep chatting with me after this. This is a subject that I really love. I've been doing it for a while, as you're going to learn in about 1 minute. And we obviously don't have enough time. I'm John Storyk. I'm the founder of co-founder of Walter Storyk Design Group, and basically for 43 years, more or less continuously, have been, among other things, designing recording studios. We have about 3,000 studios that we've worked on, and still working. So why learning from Electric Lady Studios? Well, Jimi, who of course we all know, although I didn't know it when I was young, I learned a lot from this. He changed our lives, and he changed our studio lives. He certainly changed our music lives, and he also, maybe he did know it, I'm not really sure, we're not going to know, changed also the studio lives, and he changed my life. It was my first studio, which basically means I'm old. That's all it really means. Okay, let's just get that out of the way. And yes, I did meet Jimi a few times, but not really that much. I spent most of my time working with Eddie Kramer on that studio. So let's just take a quick history lesson, because I think it puts things in perspective. Here's a typical studio in the 50s, and what do you see here? Okay, you see a really ugly room. Try to not get too focused on the equipment. Actually, some of the equipment is probably really cool, and you'd probably pay a fortune for some of it. Okay, I'm not quite sure if the equipment's gotten better. I guess this is the wrong place to say that, isn't it? Now that I think about it, but it's just gotten different, and we all know that, and we're not going to spend too much time talking about that. But architecturally and acoustically, what do we see here? We see a dingy little room that's paying very little attention to acoustics, no attention at all to ergonomics, to comfort, creature comfort, personalization, God forbid, color, feel, vibe, music, no attention. This is a room that holds an engineer, a kludgy configuration of equipment made by a potpourri of manufacturers and lunatics to try and do one thing, record. The artist, the art, is on the other side of the glass, not invited into this room. No business in this room. And there's an industry that parallels that paradigm. It's called the recording industry. Okay? 1950s, not that long ago. I mean, many people are not here in the 50s, but it's not that long ago. Okay. Nevertheless, incredible music did get made. Okay? Why? Because of the artists. The artists drive everything. The music drives everything. I love coming here because the leaders of this company are musicians. That's what's so cool. And later on, after the break, you're going to actually see proof of their passion towards it, because most of you know PreSonus has grown and is moving, because it's outlived its current home, and in the middle of its new home, soon to be open, is a full-fledged recording studio, and one of my associates and friends and project manager, Josh Morris, is going to actually share how that thinking was and the build-out of it, and actually pictures up until a few minutes ago of that facility as a way of not only advertising for PreSonus, but also sharing with you some studio construction techniques, etc. So great stuff happens in these studios. You all know who this is. This is Abbey Road, etc. Okay, and we finally come through that and we get to this. Now we have a studio with extraordinary acoustics. These are rooms for artists. These are rooms that feel good, look good. They hold the coolest equipment. And believe it or not, they actually cost less than the studios from 40 years ago. I mean less in real dollars. I don't mean less in comparative dollars. They actually cost less in dollars. So how can we get cooler, better rooms, okay, that sound better for less dollars? We're in an amazing industry. It's because of the art. It's one of the reasons I keep doing this. So how'd we get this? How'd this all happen? Okay? The artist takes control. The era of great recording studios, admittedly a little bit confused by a kind of a upside-down business model, in my opinion, okay, nevertheless takes place. Okay, how did it happen? It happened, I think, because a number of passionate artists, okay, took control and basically said no to the recording industry. We're not going to make records in those few studios, your studios. We're going to make records in our studios. We're going to make them under our terms. We'll be our own producers. All of this sound familiar? It should, because that's what's happening now. But it didn't always happen like that. One such artist was Jimi. Okay, now, when I started working and when I worked on his studio, I was a young man. I was 22. I had no idea about this. I'd actually never been in a studio. And I didn't know anything about the recording industry, okay? And it wasn't for many years later that I, you know, history, sometimes you don't realize you're, in fact, usually you don't realize you're in history when it's happening. History is what you think about after it's happened, okay? So how does this happen? So I figured it would be interesting, already a few people have come up to me, to know about the story of this studio. It's pretty well documented, but let's take a look at it. Maybe you'll see a few things you haven't seen before. That's the building, okay? And the building is still there. It's in the basement of this building on 8th Street in New York City, okay? And it was built in the early 20s. And if serendipity, one of my favorite words, were to ever strike, it certainly struck for me at this moment in my life in about four or five ways. I'm an architecture student in the 60s, down the road at Princeton, and studying in a very Corbeau-oriented architectural school, Bauhaus and Corbeau. But for some reason, I had fallen in love with a Viennese architect by the name of Frederick Kiesler. Most of you have never heard of Frederick Kiesler because he only really did two buildings. This is one of them. He was a young man. He came over from Vienna and he built and designed this building for the Film Guild of New York, because inside this building on the ground floor was that film theater. First theater not to have a stage in the United States. Look at this in 1920-something. It was extraordinary. It was so far ahead of its time, he never got another commission for about 40, 50 years until he designed this building, which was a building I had seen. Some of you may have known this building. This is a building at the end of his life. There he is on the right, the Dead Sea Scrolls Museum in Jerusalem. This is a building that I did know and very much influenced me. I loved this building, and I've been there a few times. It's extraordinary. Okay, so he only does two buildings. I was in this building, and I knew of the other building, but I didn't really know where it was, even though I had walked in front of it many times. I never knew the address of it. Okay. In the basement of this building was a club, sort of a polka club, kind of a speakeasy polka club that existed for many years until the 60s when it became a blues club called The Generation, where a lot of blues players used to go. Now, I was also in a blues band. I'm a musician, frustrated, okay, and I used to go to this club. So serendipity point number two, I'm now visiting this club in the 60s, still not knowing I'm in the basement of Frederick Kiesler's building. No idea. And one night actually saw a young, unknown, left-handed guitar player get up on stage and play with Buddy Miles and Junior Wells. Serendipity strikes for a third time. Didn't even really know who it was, since I'm not a guitar player. Took a few years for him. It's Jimi Hendrix, of course, we're talking about. All this happening. Okay, now, Jimi buys the club because, well, there's some rumors, maybe his bar bill was too much, who knows. And he wants to convert it to a club. At the time, I had gotten a small commission out of school to do an experimental nightclub. It got built. I worked on it for free. It became famous. And a lot of people used to go to it. And Jimi went to it one night. And he said, find the kid that did that club. Now, that's a whole other story that we don't have time to tell. And that's an even more bizarre story, how I got that job in the 60s in New York. Try and imagine the 60s in New York. Okay, and so Jimi, I get a call from his manager to do the club, and I do design the club. I only have one drawing of the club, that's it, and he wanted things to have curves and changing lights, because this club that I had done had changing lights and environments, and in the back of the club would be a small room that you could record in. That was his concept. Oh, shit, that's why you can't record this. Okay, see? small recording room in the back of this club in the basement. Curves and a stage and dressing room and whatnot. And it was all very exciting, and here I am thinking I'm going to do a club for Jimi Hendrix. His producer engineer, Eddie Kramer, lifetime friend, scraps the project, convinces him not to build it, and talks him into building a full-on recording studio. So I watched my first commission evaporate before it even took off. I'd never been in a studio, but somehow they allowed me to stay on the project. I quit my job. I interned for another acoustician who helped with the detailing. Kind of self-taught myself this industry, learned about recording studios, and a year and 3 months later, the studio was built. Okay, that's the layout, more or less how it is today, how it was built. You can see now, although the control room has changed, this is not working. So who's ever on the technical team here from PreSonus, see if you can deal with the batteries on this. Okay, thanks. Thank you. You can see the Studio A is still there. You came down the basement. It's still in the basement. There's nothing on the ground floor. The film theater still existed then. Okay. Here's an original drawing. That's me, a little bit younger drawing. You can see that there are three studios. If you look very carefully, there are two over on the left and one big one on the right. That got changed on when we laid it out. Eddie looked at it, didn't like it, so we had to redraw it. Okay. And here's a few, you can see a section drawing, you see the sloping ceiling, the theater underneath, okay, big thick concrete rooms. Okay, that was the front, which even the front had curves and you walked in. Unfortunately, it got torn down about 15 years ago, it's too bad. But you still walk in today and go down a stair. Same stair that's been there for almost 45 years. Construction begins. This was a terrific site for a studio. Little did I know that many of the techniques that we use there, still using today. It's a slab on grade, which is always the best location for a studio. So we're immediately jumping into our acoustics class. Thank you very much. There you go. Okay, very few columns, very tall ceilings. Can't really have too much height in studio construction. We'll see why. Okay, thick concrete slab. It almost had enough isolation between the theater and the studio. Frederick Kiesler was from Europe. Europe, of course, was much further advanced than the United States in concrete construction in the first part of the 20th century. Concrete really comes from Europe, the technology, and understood concrete very well, as a matter of fact. And so construction starts. We used sand-filled block, double block construction for all the walls. Still, this day, a great isolation technique for isolating one studio from another. It was obvious that Jimi was gonna work very loud. So there are the footings for it. And yes, when we dug the footings, we did discover a river, and all those things that you've heard are indeed true. And to this day, they still have two pumps that pump the water out because there's a high water table there. About 1 inch too far. Because one day it was like Yosemite in there and it never was the same. It was better that we found it, yes, yeah. And during Sandy, that was the battle. The battle wasn't the water, the battle was getting gasoline for the pumps because they kept the generator going because all the electricity was out in lower Manhattan. That was and they did win that battle because it would have been they would have lost the studio. And it finally gets built. Notice, although the control room is certainly not a contemporary shape and has a lot of issues, but it's big. That was the concept, big. Big piece of glass. No longer is there a boundary between the control room and the studio. They're the same. The engineer and the producer are the artists. Okay, they're on one side of the glass, they're on another side of the glass. Okay, there's the big change that was taking place. And so, is this a commercial studio? Is this a project studio? Is this a personalized studio? Is this a themed studio? Destination studio? I'm throwing out one word after another. You know, it's 1969, we don't give it a name. It's just Electric Lady Studios. And it wasn't for many years before I realized what was actually happening right in front of my eyes. I had no idea. To me, this was what a studio was supposed to be. Okay, oversized air conditioning ducts. Some of you are very familiar with that. Still there. 1 year later, the studio is finished. And some of the original concepts from the club were kept. The curves, this twisting ceiling idea, that I never changed. We used a kind of an air-entrained plaster to make it half reflective and half absorptive. It's still there, nothing's changed. We were so nervous that this ceiling wouldn't be effective that we carpeted half the floor, but actually the ceiling was more efficient than we thought, and the carpet has long since been removed. It's pretty rare to use carpet in a live room now. You can always put a carpet down. It's hard to put wood down on top of a carpet. And all the changing lights were, of course, we had all these bulbs and big dimmers and whatnot. Now you can get all the stuff at Home Depot and do it all. But, you know, this was Jimmy's idea, is that it was a changing environment, okay? And I like this picture. I like some of the other pictures because it shows the studio being used so many times, and I'm guilty of it. You're going to see a lot of pictures, the sort of beauty shots. It's not really what happens in studios. Studios are supposed to be funky. They're messy. They're like shops. They're workplaces. But we take the pretty pictures, you know, for magazines and all that kind of stuff. So, but this was a personalized studio. So this started out as Jimmy's studio, but it was built to specifications that it could be rented. But it was always for musicians. It was for people to park themselves there, be very safe, very secure, okay, and work for long periods of time. That's still the model today, okay? A lot of people have worked there. Of course, Jimmy didn't get to work there very long, but it's almost like somebody was watching. He died, and almost within months, Stevie Wonder parked himself there for a year. It's almost like one artist left, and another unbelievable artist put himself before he moved to California permanently. That's Eddie Kramer, much younger, and Jim Maron was the manager who had managed the club, and he's passed away 2 years ago also, unfortunately. Good guy. So there's some shots. Lena Horne, a very young Jimmy Page, of course, and a much younger, still thin, Robert Plant. And then Stevie arrives, and we can just go through these. One day I had an intern. Hey, could you just go see if you can figure out albums that have been done at Electric Lady? It got up to like 300, and I said, okay, no, we don't need 300 albums, we need 10. You know, so it, you know, it's been kind of a who's who that's gone through it, and it still is, actually more than ever. The studio is packed. It's had an extraordinary history. Almost went out of business, okay? A young intern kind of picked it up, has become the studio manager, there's new owners, and the studio is actually healthier than ever, and today one of the three big studios in New York City, almost 45 years old. The control room has changed, was changed a few times, and now, of course, it's even changed since this picture, because this is an SSL, now it has a Neve with an Augsburger-type horn monitoring system, et cetera, et cetera. But the studio is still more or less the same, and that picture shows it there. There it is. It's nothing really has changed. That was in the lobby. It's now moved to the studio, which I think it looks better. It was a mural that Jimmy had commissioned. So without realizing it, right in front of me were the seeds for the dilemma for I believe, what we want to talk about today, which is project studios. So little did I know that we were building, or that I was involved, in a project studio. Even though it's had a long commercial success, and today it's still a commercial studio, the roots of its origins and the soul of the studio and its purpose for being started because one person wanted a personal project studio. It's also in Lower Manhattan. Studios didn't exist in Lower Manhattan. Now, of course, they're everywhere. Brooklyn, they're everywhere, okay? And as we were talking before, everyone in this room has a studio. You have one. You have it on you right now. You got an iPhone, you have a studio. Okay, everybody has a studio. I mean, if we were ever in the home of a company that believes that, it would be PreSonus. Okay, so let's flirt a little bit with that idea. This is my favorite picture. Very few photos of Jimmy in the studio because of his untimely death. So we have to do some acoustics in a lecture like this. We're going to try to run through this in 15 minutes. This, of course, is almost an absurd notion because it would more or less negate 43 years if we could do it in 15 minutes, but that in a sense is the challenge, okay? But let's do a little bit, since you wouldn't be here if you weren't interested in studio design, and obviously studios are specialized spaces that are soulful, are personalized, they house equipment that we need for recording and for post-production, and they have good or satisfactory acoustics. So what is good and what is satisfactory? That's, of course, a pretty interesting issue. This may be the most important slide if you're thinking about a studio. You're trying to understand the studio from an acoustical point of view. It's to understand which world we're in. Are you in the quietness world, or are you in the how does sound respond world? Are we trying to isolate, or are we trying to deal with how sound behaves? We're usually always trying to deal with the second. The money is in the first. That's where the money is. That's where the problems are. It's the hardest one to control. Sometimes we need to control it socially. Socially means I just don't play loud. Or socially means I don't mind the siren, or I just won't record when it's raining, etc. That would be a social solution to a physical problem. But that's where the money is. But these two worlds, although they use similar acoustic principles, are in fact quite different. Okay, and so when you now use the word soundproofing, that doesn't mean anything. We hate that word in our office. What does that mean? Does that mean putting up curtains? Or does that mean a better door so I don't hear people in the hall? Depends on which person you're talking to. Okay, so know what you're talking about. In our world also, everything is frequency dependent. So you no longer can do something like say it's 94 dB loud in here. That doesn't mean anything. 94 dBc, that does mean something. 94 dB SPL, 94 dB, which is an average, 94 dB at 1K, etc. So we need frequency information. Everything in acoustics, virtually everything, has to have a frequency associated with it or some frequency band. We usually use 8 octave bands or 1/3 octave bands. You're all familiar with that. But understand that. Things don't behave the same way at low frequencies as they do at high frequencies. You know this intuitively, but it comes to play in a big way when we come to designing studios. Speed of sound, okay, we all know that. This is the only formula you really have to know. Speed of sound is equal to the frequency times its associated wavelength. And you've seen this a million times and you've memorized it and that's good. But now let's look at it a different way. Speed of sound is God. That's just the world we're in, at least if we're in air. If we're in the water, it's different. But most of us are building studios in the air, on Earth, not too many underwater studios, equals frequency, that's what you hear, times the wavelength, which is architecture. So this could really now mean God equals architecture times sound. That's how I see this formula. This is the formula that relates what we hear and experience to size and dimensions and inches and feet and meters. And that's the world we're in. Okay? It's very interesting. So when you start thinking about 113 hertz note, which has a wavelength of 10 feet, being generated in a small ISO booth that doesn't even have a 13-foot dimension in it, how are we going to get one full wave to get fully propagated in that room? Can I even hear that sound in that room? Of course you can, because you have. But we're never going to get a full wave to be propagated and or bounce back on itself. So the modal behavior, the low frequency wave behavior, is going to be very different in that room than compared to, say, for instance, this room, where I can get 113 hertz, the wavelength, 10 feet, to propagate itself a few times before it hits a stiff boundary. And stiff boundaries are usually what we have in studios, because stiff boundaries, along with a few other techniques, are at the root of keeping studios quiet. That's that isolation. So already you can see that I've tried to confuse you with about 6 notions all at the same time. And this is the dilemma in trying to run through this in 15 minutes, okay? Which is that there are a lot of concepts that you have to know all of them, and they're all iterative. They're all kind of wiggling and relating around each other. This is why, personally, I still do this, because I find this all very interesting and very fascinating. So from a low frequency point of view, this room would be better if these walls were thin. Because some of the low-frequency energy would go out, which means it would be absorbed, which means it wouldn't bounce back, which means it wouldn't behave modally, which means I wouldn't have eigentone buildup or standing waves, as some of you refer to it as. However, if these rooms were really thin, then when we blasted a note in here, it would be bothering the next room. So, okay for internal room acoustics, not too good for isolation acoustics. Oops. So, think about that just for a minute. Okay. So let's take a look at some basics on isolation. Some of you, I'm actually not even really gonna dwell on this, because I wanna look at pictures, really. It just occurred to me that that's what I wanna do. So we measure quietness by noise criteria curves, among other reasons. We don't hear as well at low frequencies. Many of you know that. So you see these values. Basically, if the rooms are not breaking these NC lines, that's the descriptive single number value for how quiet a room is. Be a little careful, because, for instance, these two rooms, the yellow room and the blue room, are both NC35 rooms, but they're not the same. usually most rooms follow these curves because we don't hear so well at low frequencies, so we're allowed more noise at low frequencies, but microphones do. So now we have another dilemma. Are studios for our ears or for microphones? They're both receiving transducers. Think about that, okay? So this is the world we're in. Studios, very quiet, very low NC values. Rooms with microphones usually want to be NC 15, very quiet. Whereas you can see the value in other, by the way, these are decibelic in nature, and decibels, okay, we know that 3 decibels are double the energy. So a 5 decibel difference is actually quite a bit. Okay? However, don't make the mistake of making rooms too quiet. For instance, to design a control room to NC 15, which is essentially an air conditioning exercise, is truly a waste of money because the equipment alone is probably going to take that room over NC 15. Okay, so you can, you know, I ask people, well, how quiet should your control room be? And they say, as quiet as possible. I said, that's not necessarily the right answer. You're going to be wasting a lot of money. Okay? In a inexpensive personal studio, a studio where budget is an issue, a lot of the studios that everybody's interested in here, okay, sometimes we'll just isolate the ISO booth because that's where the microphone needs to be, and we won't isolate or fully isolate the control room, trying to save some money. It's okay if it's a little bit noisy, okay? All right, so all of this is about trying to get the right boundaries, okay? So transmission loss, and in this simple diagram, how do you choose the right boundary solution, which is floor, walls, and ceilings? You need a send and you need a receive. Every boundary has got a send and a receive. Somebody's making noise and somebody's being bothered on a frequency by frequency basis. Figure out the send value, figure out what you need the receive value to be, subtract the two approximately. This is not 100% true, approximately, because there's a little bit of a value here for the absorption on the receive side. And on a frequency by frequency basis, you'll have the TL of a boundary. So in reverse, when we're designing, we can look it up. Okay, the more mass, usually the better the transmission loss. But we get to a moment where for some frequencies, adding more mass will not do the job. We need decoupling. So we now have the two backbones of isolation, mass and decoupling. If you put enough mass, you almost don't need any decoupling, like 12-inch sand-filled block, okay, for a studio that's basically in the woods, that's it. You don't need any more isolation. You don't need a second system because there's not enough noise on the outside, okay? But on the 6th floor of a commercial building in New York City, where you couldn't even put 12 inches of sand-filled block because it would be on the 5th floor, okay? We have to use lightweight construction, multiple layers of sheetrock, stud, et cetera, et cetera. And now we need double layers and triple layers, okay, with isolation, or if we have a lot of rooms next to each other, okay? So sometimes we choose our construction techniques not for the best technique, but for the best social technique. There's a lot of different techniques. Masonry is one. Drywall and layering on metal studs is kind of the lingua franca in this country. Other countries, that's expensive. When you go to South America, masonry is cheap. Masonry is expensive here. Okay, there's also panelized construction. So different types of construction sometimes are chosen not because they're the best solutions, but because they're the best social solutions. Okay, I was on a project recently in New York where they're going to build the walls out of wood studs. I haven't used wood studs in years. Why? Because stagehands are going to do the work. It's in the basement of a movie theater. The union stagehands, they don't work in metal studs. These guys are building sets. It's all wood. And I was shocked when I heard that the walls were going to be built out of wood. And the guy just looked at me and said, local, whatever the local number was, that was it. I'm going to skip this. Basically, sound transmission class, if anyone's interested, talk to me. It's a way to sort of try to predict. Let's just skip through this, because I can see. It's a one-number value a one-number value associated with the transmission loss through all frequencies for any boundary system. But it's not an arithmetic average. It's a complicated average, and it weights frequencies, and it also weights the notion that membranic boundaries, thin boundaries, and all boundaries are membranic to a certain extent, particularly drywall boundaries, will fail at certain frequencies, okay? Okay, and so the STC curve, it's actually 3 straight lines, takes that into account. It's called the coincidence dip. The coincidence dip frequency for sheetrock, for instance, is 2,500. Okay? So, but in general, an STC value that's higher is better. So doors, for instance, are in the high 40s. Recently, 2 years ago, a door manufacturer finally figured out how to make a 1 3/4 inch metal door that had an STC value in the mid 50s. I didn't even believe you could do it, but they did it. I mean, we can make a single door in the 50s, it's just very thick. Okay, so even something as boring as acoustical doors, and it is rather boring, okay, there's still a breakthrough. There's always just somebody pushing the window just a little bit more. This is very good for us. Okay, so for instance, this wall, pretty robust, extra layers of sheetrock, special clips, pretty high STC value. This is almost good enough for a poor man, I shouldn't say poor man's, for a sort of a marginal recording studio between a control room and a live microphone room. But a more typical wall would be this. Now we're into the low 60s. These are laboratory values, so when you see an STC 62 for this wall, you're probably not going to get it in the field. It's going to be a little bit lower. It's never going to be exactly what the labs are testing it at. And this is a more typical wall between control rooms and studios, okay, a two-wall system. Sometimes we use a three-wall system if we know the levels are going to be louder, okay, in the control room. Okay, and this is the kind of solution that we have at PreSonus, although the floor is a little bit different, and Josh is going to show you that for any of you that are interested in that a little bit later on in the next talk. And now you can see two distinct walls, two distinct floor systems. Here, these are built-up isolated floors on an isolated system, and then the ceilings are even distinct. Here they are being suspended by springs. You can already see there's a lot of details going on, using the right spring spacing, making sure these two walls, which have to be connected during construction, are acoustically decoupled, separation of the floor, what kind of spacing on the floor isolators, how much mass on the floor, beat goes on. The concept is the same, mass and decoupling, commonly called a floating floor. Nothing really floats. There's no floating going on here. Okay, no, nothing floating, decoupled. That's the bigger word. Go to school, decoupled. Okay, racing through this, got 15 minutes, two more minutes left. So mass and decoupling, that's the key. Okay, this is why in a lot of studios, the wall thicknesses are sort of similar, because the conditions are similar. We're not inventing the wheel with each studio. Studio control rooms like to work reasonably loud, and microphones like to not get disturbed by them. How quiet does the studio have to be? Quiet enough so that the intruding noise is not heard on a U67. That's how quiet. Any quieter, it's a waste of money. Not that quiet, you don't have a recording, or you'll have to be satisfied with bleed on your recording. That's why the specs are very similar in studios. But there's a lot of different kinds of studios. Some studios don't actually work very loud. Audio post studios, broadcasting studios, studios for TV where 85 is zero, okay, are not going to work as loud as Green Day's studio or Jay-Z's studio, where I had plugs on and I still had to walk out when they were. I couldn't stay in the room. It was impossible. So, different studios for different people. We're going to see them in a minute. This should scare you, okay? Because it scares me. There's a lot of things that can go wrong here, and the problem in isolation is that it's very hard to test isolation until it's all done. You think about it, there's always going to be a hole in the wall. Doors don't go in until you're through, windows don't go in until you're through, so it's very hard. We're looking at a lot of photos every week. Josh is going to discuss this at the PreSonus. We were just there yesterday, even finding yet another little detail that we had to modify. That's what we do. And it scares us, because if it doesn't work, of course, you know who gets the call. Okay, here's a little sequence just to show you. I won't even show you what kind of room this is in, but it's a room that's going to be fully isolated with a suspended ceiling. Here are the rods that are being suspended, and then the springs. The layout has to be exact, different springs on the perimeter because the loads are different. Springs are not easy, but sometimes it's our only option. We put some fireproofing on the underside. There comes the Chicago, the black is the structural black iron, and then the furring strips going the other direction. Then the layers, in this case, we like to use sheetrock, plywood sheetrock. We've been having a lot of luck with that. Is that going to come out in a slide? You'll see that next. We use the plywood in the middle for two reasons. It gives us a different material, same labor, three layers, different material, so we shift this coincidence dip that I was talking about. By using a different material, we flatten out the tendency for the sheetrock to fail at a certain frequency. So we, and also it gives us a continuous nailer. We don't have to worry about attaching anything to the walls and the ceiling, whereas before we'd have to put blocking up, and we're hanging things from the ceiling a lot, or applying treatments to the wall. So now every surface is ready to be screwed into. And the labor is about the same. The plywood, cheap plywood, you know, sheathing plywood doesn't really cost that much different than chipboard. So we're having a lot of luck with that particular sandwich configuration. Seams are cross-layered, and these are the rooms that that detail applied to. Both of these are fully isolated rooms. This is a kind of a studio practice living room for somebody, and this is the back end of a home theater, fully isolated because these were taking place in residential buildings, and they wanted to run levels about 100 dBC, and they had to be fully isolated. So no sacrifice for architecture, okay, if we want our isolation. It's unrelated. I mean, related to a certain extent, but unrelated. On the other hand, we could have had these rooms without that isolation. Just means you can't play loud, or you have to buy the next apartment, or you're going to get sued, or whatever. Okay? So the, how these rooms behave internally have very little to do with the isolation, except if they're fully isolated, the boundaries get stiff 99% of the time. And when boundaries are stiff, nothing can go through them. When low frequencies hit stiff boundaries, they come back in the room, and they affect the modal or low frequency response of the room, and that's very critical. And the smaller the room, the worse the problem. Not the better, it's just completely counterintuitive. The smaller the room, and rooms are getting smaller and smaller because real estate's expensive, the worse the problem. And that's because the fundamental eigentone, or the lowest tone where you can have a fully developed standing wave, is higher. Some of you understand what I'm talking about, and most of you are saying, what the hell is he talking about? Because it involves a little bit of math. For those who just have no idea what I'm talking about, you need to trust me on this. The smaller rooms are actually harder. Okay? This room doesn't have much modal behavior. Okay? Because the fundamental eigentone starts probably below the frequency you can hear it at. If you go to a big arena, there's no modal tones. There's no standing waves in the arenas. It's all about reverberation time. But when you get into tiny little stiff boundaried rooms, it's all about modal rooms, and it's not about, there's no reverberation. The reverberation time is already little because the room's small. It's just exactly the opposite of what you would intuit. This is the challenge. We have more and more small rooms, and we have more low frequency. Everything converging. It's what's making it interesting. A little bit of job security also. Okay, so this big studio, this is, in Vancouver, you can take a look for Electronic Arts. Look at this. Look at the intensity of that boundary. Why? Because our planning forced us to put two studios right next to each other. It's a horrible thing to do. We had no choice. We just couldn't squeeze them in. That's a much better layout. See how this studio here got a nice corridor between it? That's the way you want to lay out rooms. Here, can we do it? Yeah, you have to have a really intense wall, which you can see in plan. And there it is right there. Four-wall system. Two walls equal the one internal wall. There's a difference in level because one studio is lower than the other. And then an internal system here and an internal system here. Now, here our decoupled floors are actually separately poured concrete slabs. Always the best. And that is, in fact, exactly what we did at PreSonus. Of course, you need new construction to do that. Or you can take an existing warehouse and cut the slabs, which is what we did at Electric Lady 43 years ago. 43 years ago. Exactly the same. And in PreSonus, because, no, there we poured, it's a brand new building, right? Yeah, brand new building, so we just poured separate slab, driving the builder a little bit nuts in the beginning, and you get that RFI, you get the phone call one day, you know, I could save you a lot of money if we don't have to pour all these separate slabs. Not really, because then we're going to have to add all of this stuff later on. And they struggle with it, and it's not so easy to pour separate slabs in the beginning of a job. Remember, these are not easily shaped rooms, but it pays off. And you can see it right there. There's the room where they're at the same level. Okay, in that drawing. But in the end, no sacrifice to architecture. This is an extraordinary room. Putting three big monitors on top of a big piece of glass is not fun. We're not going to talk, anybody that wants to discuss that, hit me up later. That is not that easy to do. It's the gaming industry is the first studio where we had a full size monitor 5.1 system. The gaming industry has always been paying attention to surround way before the audio. In fact, we're getting almost no request for surround. The whole surround thing has kind of imploded in audio, in pure music audio. Now in film, we're all over the place. 5.1, 7.1, now 22.2, immersive, Atmos, Oro, they're going crazy there. But studios, you want a wire for surround? And I'm getting laughed at. No, not really. I mean, they're just saying no. Anyway, okay, so that's the crash course in isolation acoustics. Not really fair. We have air conditioning to deal with, doors. God is in the details. It's all about the details. It's all about the penetrations. You have never been in a room that doesn't have holes. How could you have gotten into the room? So a lot of holes. So it's how you deal with the holes, okay? And in fact, I know that Josh will discuss one such incident even in our PreSonus. We learn from our mistakes. It's not a mistake. It was just a glitch, and we correct it, and we move on, and we'll, for some of you that are interested, stick around for the next one. It'll be quite fascinating. So, okay, we have our quiet room or our quiet environment. Now, how does it behave? What happens in the room? How do we get this kind of industry standard for uncolored behavior, which everybody is sort of in agreement in, but not completely in agreement in? Well, that is a huge subject, okay? It's like saying, how do we describe a car? How many characteristics does it take to tell me about a car? I don't know, 5, 10, 20, more than one. Let's look at a few. That's all we can look at. There's a lot, and it depends on what room you're in. First, let's look at reverb time, which applies for certainly live rooms. Every room has a reverb time or a decay rate. As the rooms get smaller, which control rooms are, the reverb time becomes less of an issue, but it does still have a decay rate, okay? You have to have a decay rate, okay? Reverb time classically is defined, we all know that, the amount of energy to 60 decibels, which is 1 millionth the energy. So we get this RT60, but we can measure RT10 and RT20, multiply out for 60, okay? If you think about it, and somebody did think about it many years ago, Wallace Sabine, over 100 years ago, reverb time is proportional to volume. If the volume gets bigger, it's just going to have a bigger reverb time. It's going to take longer to get to boundaries and come back. It's pretty simple. Turns out it's perfectly proportional, okay? And it's inversely proportional to the absorption. If I bring in 6 big giant styrofoam balls and put them in the room, it's going to get deader. Okay, anybody that's ever mixed a big auditorium knows that when sound check doesn't sound the same when the 15,000 people come in, which is why they have all that music, which is why the second song usually sounds better than the first song. And everybody, I see some heads here, so that means there's some live sound guys here, because you just added 15,000 times 6 Sabines. A person is about 6 Sabines of absorption. And in fact, that is the classic Sabine reverberation equation. We can put a little bit of a constant on it to go get some number values, okay, and there we are. And all we have to do is figure out how to, it's easy to calculate volume, what does that mean? So what is the absorption in this room? Well, other than people are not a big deal in studios because there's not a lot of people in studios. The absorption is usually a function of surfaces, so it's kind of all of the surfaces times some kind of absorption coefficient. But we got different surfaces, so we'll just divide the room up into the different types of surfaces. Maybe the walls have one value and the floors have another and the ceiling, whatever. You just keep dividing it up and you get this kind of thing, and you just, looks a little bit googly gooky, but it's really not, just one surface times its coefficient, and you just keep going out. That's how mathematicians do it, and bingo, you're right home, and there it is. It looks like you know what you're doing. Okay, it's not that complicated. This is just Sabines. This is just absorption on the bottom. And that's a constant to give us in seconds if we're dealing with inches and feet. If you're in metric, it's a different value. There you go. So the classic Sabine equation. There's a few others that have some different components in it, but this one works for medium to large spaces. It works very nicely. We use it all the time. Okay? And we're constantly trying to predict the reverberation time against known reverberation times that experience tells us are the sort of high, the minimum and maximum values on a per volume and per room type basis, okay? So let's take a look at this room. Here's an old TEF spin out. Here's a room, we're gonna throw some sound in it, okay, and then we're gonna cut it off. Of course, there you see frequency and level, okay? Time doesn't go backwards, we're just looking at it. backwards so I can see it, like Niagara Falls. It's, time does march forward, no physics paradigm here. And we shut it off, and I'm going to take a look at it half a second later. What's going on in this room? Okay, that's what's going on in this room. This is an easy measurement to get. You can get this measurement for $20 on your iPhone. That's how democratic everything has gotten. All of you own this testing equipment. You just need an app, bingo, get a microphone. One of our associates, one of our interns, now one of our staff members, actually had a paper at the AES showing how close the iPhone technology, the iPhone measuring technology was to $10,000 B&K equipment. That did not make B&K very happy, I can tell you that. They did not come around to that poster at all. Not once. I didn't see any of those guys near there. Yet, of course, we own a B&K. We own all that stuff, but I also, when I'm stuck, hey, there it is right there, and I use it all the time. Okay? So, what? Can you tell me how big this room is? No, you can't. Anybody that thinks they can, I'm not even going to waste 1 second. You can't. What you can tell me is something about this room. What's going on? The low frequency is not behaving the same as the high frequency. Something's going on in this room. There's a mismatch of treatment. Something that I applied on the walls and ceiling is not making it behave in a similar way to when we started, which is in our world, this is relatively flat. Probably put up too much broadband absorption, too much foam, too many curtains, which in the music, full frequency, which is what we're about here, this is about music, this is not a good deal. For speech, this would be a good deal. Depends on what the purpose of the room is. Okay? This is reverberation time. It's a valuable tool. It's a valuable standard. It is not the only standard. It's not the only way that we judge the internal acoustic responsiveness of an environment, but it's an important one. Okay? It's an important one, and it's one that we have a lot of data about. Okay? So we get these kinds of curves. Music usually wants more reverberation than speech. Notice it's a function of volume. Where's frequency? Where's my frequency value that I kept yelling and telling you all that we need? It's not in here, but it's in here in a footnote. Usually when you see a document like this, it means either at 1K or the average of the inside four octave bands, or it's 1K with a percentage of deviation, both bottom and top. That's how THX and Dolby use their standards. There's got to be some way of getting all of the frequencies in here, okay? Let's take a look at another chart. Now, this is a chart that gives us very, very clear upper and lower diagrams as a function of values, as a function of type. Not all types should have the same. Churches should be more reverberant than speech rooms. Speech rooms want very high speech intelligibility, usually want to be deader. Music rooms want to be more reverberant, more natural, musical sound. So we have different standards for different room types. What can we do in rooms? Think about it. There's only four things we can do. We can change the shape of the room, geometry. We can make surfaces reflective, absorptive, or diffusive, or some combination of them at various frequencies. Now, that's a lot of palette, but that's what we're doing in rooms. The way this room sounds, besides the content and the responsiveness of the reinforcement system, is a function of the size of the room and what's on the surfaces of this room. That's what you're hearing. That's what's affecting what you're hearing. That's the system. Okay, and as we get into smaller, very exact rooms, i.e. control rooms, where the delivery system is very accurate, I mean, the universe of control room monitors is extraordinary. It's like, if I see one more company making a control room monitor, I'm going to collapse, because that now I got 15 good ones instead of 13 good ones. One's more amazing than the next. They don't all do the same thing. Some get louder. It's merely style issues. It's like debating a Mercedes versus a BMW. It's a silly debate. It's just a style issue, okay? But the room is as, if not more, important than the monitoring system, and often neglected. That's the reason for our spending some time together. If you don't have this diagram, it just means you don't have a room. But you do have a room, so you have to have direct sound, and you have to have reflections. How those reflections bounce around, when they arrive to you, at what level, is the acoustic signature of the room. That's the acoustic signature of the room, okay? And it's a complicated one. So take a look at this quick diagram, okay, of direct sound bouncing off of a wall. What's really happening? We're getting a mirror source or a second image coming a little bit later in distance, which is time. So you get the direct source, and if the radiation pattern out of the transducer is wide enough, which it often is in good monitors, I get like another source for free. The good news is I get a second source for free a little later in time. The bad news is I get a second source for free a little later in time. It's the same news. It's called a comb filter, particularly if it's 2, 3, 4, 5 milliseconds. Small rooms, again, small rooms harder than big rooms. Don't have this problem in big rooms. Okay, plenty of distance between you, the monitor, you, and the boundaries, plenty of distance between the back of monitors often, et cetera, or they're baffled. But as the rooms get smaller, the risk of close boundaries just gets worse and worse and worse. How do we solve it? Historically, people foam it up. They just put absorption there. Okay, why don't I like that? Well, usually thin absorption just deals with certain frequencies, particularly mid-band frequencies, doesn't deal with low frequencies. It also just keeps making the room deader. And as the room gets deader, you get a situation where you can't move very far out of a sweet spot. You've all been in those kinds of rooms, okay, until you're finally going towards an anechoic chamber, which is absurd to work in. So why not try to deal with it geometrically before you use the treatment? See if you can get the geometry to help you before you put the treatment, and then only put the treatment where you need it. Okay, we'll see examples of that. So if I just angle the wall a little bit, I don't have a reflection anymore. This is obviously a two-dimensional room, and it's a theoretical bounce, but it's true. And that's at the heart and soul of what we try to do. Couple that task or that mission with trying to do everything else in these rooms, including many non-acoustic or technical things. Rooms are architecture. They have to have doors, windows, couches, chairs, seats, air conditioning, lights. They have to be legal, codes, fire. Just, it goes on and on and on. Then they have to get built on time by builders who often don't know what they're doing, filed, et cetera, et cetera. And now you're in my world 10 hours a day. And I'm not complaining. I wouldn't trade it for another world, okay? But we can reduce it to this every now and then. And we do. And we try. And you should try too. So we'll take a look at only two other little characteristics. This is the scary one, the comb filter. Everybody kind of knows what comb filtering is. That's a small reminder. You should know it. If you're here, you know what it is. Okay, just a signal coming a little bit out of phase or out of time, either canceling, okay, or reinforcing, and can cause a filter, which indeed looks like a comb. There's the math for it, very simple. Now, this is fun. This is called flanging, okay, and I think this is terrific to use when you want, but you don't want your room to do this unannounced. This is not a good thing. This is going to cause a lot of big nightmare. What can do this? Well, electronically, it's easy. But what can do this is a close reflective surface giving you that extra mirror source. Rooms get smaller. The chances of this happening are bigger. Sometimes it has nothing to do with the room. Sometimes it can be furniture. You all, of course, know where I'm going to go here. I'm going to go right. Well, first of all, let's hear what this might sound like. So a little audio. We have to have a little audio. Let's take a little demonstration, and I think it'll work. Okay, that's a little sax outdoors. Again, I'm in a room that's probably, this would be much better on headphones, if everyone wants, you know, so you can, if you're interested, you get this and put headphones on. Then we put a 2 millisecond delay in it, which would be exactly what would happen if that sax was playing to you. Okay, sax is radiating, and I got a hard wall right here with a bounce, and it came right back to you 2.2 feet later. You can do that math pretty easy. So I get a second source piling up on the first source with a 2 millisecond delay. It's creating a comb filter, and listen to it. You listen to the high note. You'll hear it kind of be a little honky. So especially that last passage is like sort of shrilling. It's flanging. Some people like it. I actually sort of do like it there. It almost feels like a kind of an old honky-tonk type thing. And that's fine, but you don't want your room to do that to a vocal, okay? If you do that to Celine Dion on her recording, you're going to get fired, okay? It's because that's not what's really happening. And now let's listen to a 3.3-foot reflection path or a 3 millisecond delay. I'll do all three. You'll hear that high one disappear. Sounds a little bit smooth again because the notes are going through a different point in this crazy filter, but you'll hear the earlier another passage sound yet a little bit different. So I'll play the first, second, and third right on top of each other. Now that's going to go away. See, that high thing is going away, and there's a nasty note in the front. This is comb filtering. What can cause that? Well, everybody has seen this, and everybody still keeps doing this. They put the near-field speakers right on top of the big consoles. Now, big consoles are disappearing, if we were ever at a conference where we know that, that's for sure. Okay. But we still have a lot of big consoles, and you don't need a big console to have a big console surface. You can take a little console and put it in a big Argosy surface, okay, and think you're a big shot, you know, and get a big surface. Okay, so it's not the console. This is why you can't record this. Because I actually like Argosy. They make very cool stuff. And that didn't come over very well, did it? No. Okay, we've been doing pretty good right up till that moment, okay? But you all know what I mean. It's just the surface that's causing the problem, okay? And there we go. There's that bounce. So you see, it's not the room at all. Room could be just fantastic, and you could just screw things up right here, okay? And now we're in a comb filter, and of course, how do we get rid of it? Just move it back, and if you've never done this, do it. I'm not a mixing engineer. I give myself about a 6 on the hearing. And you can hear this in a heartbeat. You can hear this in a heartbeat, this demonstration. There's the measurement. On the console, off the console. Look, right smack in the middle of the upper speech. That's an NS10, you know, that's any one of a dozen near-field monitors, fairly straight, roll-off as you'd expect. We got a million of them now, including PreSonus. It's hard to do, but a lot of people doing it. And there you go, stick it on that big console, and you don't have that monitor anymore. That's ridiculous. Put a big monitor on top of that glass, which millions of people have done because they want to look forward into the studio with a big monitor, and there you go, same problem. Nothing to do with the room whatsoever. I can get that monitor baffled. I can get the modal behavior of the room. I can figure out how to build it. Bing. How do we get rid of this problem? You got to move the console back. Luckily, in rooms that have big monitors with big pieces of glass, they often have big consoles and they also have big rooms. It's kind of, they all go together. So we can move it back, but sometimes we can't. So how would we solve it? Move it back, or, as in the case here, or sometimes the console solves it. Like in this case, the Neve, happens to, these old Neves, happen to kind of block the reflection. So that works out nicely for us. Or lower the monitor right into the glass. Well, that kind of defeats the whole purpose of the glass. We'll talk about that a little bit later. And now we don't have the problem. Or maybe a compromise solution like this, where we have the glass in the middle and the speakers on the side. And you've seen that before. Okay, you match the solution to the problem. Okay, but to just blindly copy one solution, copy paste into another environment, that's not designing, that's copying. And you can easily get off track very quickly. Okay, or don't have any glass at all, which is the case. Or have the glass on the side, and you'll see quite a bit of that. Okay, we often try to do that for a number of reasons. The front of studios are getting very busy. A lot of stuff has to happen in the front. Third monitor, multiple screens, a lot of play for that real estate. So big piece of glass, oh, that's a nightmare. Maybe we can look out the side. I actually think side viewing is actually preferred, but that's a personal thing. And the final thing to discuss is room modes, or eigentones, or standing waves, as many of you know, okay? Let's, by demonstration, pretend you're in a room that has only one dimension. I'm going to throw some sound in it whose wavelength is twice the distance. Okay? If I send that sound in, that wavelength, twice the distance, has a chance of bouncing off a stiff boundary and coming back fully reinforced, thus standing on itself, thus the term standing wave. That's the lowest frequency. Any frequency lower than that, which means it has a higher length, cannot do this. You can hear it, it's just going to be out of phase in some way. That's the lowest standing wave frequency or eigentone frequency. Obviously, rooms have more than one dimension. If you do this for X, Y, and Z, or width, length, and height, and every room can be rectangularized, even odd-shaped rooms can be rectangularized into an X, Y, and Z, you have eigentone calculation. You have a room mode calculator, okay? This parallel wall thing, let's get rid of that. Parallel walls, everyone said parallel walls are bad. Whoever said that is just wrong. That is completely untrue. Do not leave here thinking that. It's actually completely wrong. In fact, there are some advantages to parallel walls. Room modes can be more accurately calculated when the walls are parallel. What's bad, where everybody gets confused, is that at high frequencies, flutter echo can be confusing. Even that's not completely true. I've clapped in the back of control rooms, heard some flutter echo, and someone says, oh, listen to this, and then I would say, well, what's the problem? What's so bad? Doing a lot of clapping in the back of the control room? Nobody's clapping in the back. It's an acoustic event that's never happening. It's never going to happen. Now, in a studio, that's different because that could interfere with the life. So even flutter echo is not necessarily bad. Anyway, throw that notion right out. We do have, why do you see a lot of angles? Has nothing to do with parallel walls being bad. The angles are there because sometimes the angles help us to direct first reflections away from the listening position. That's why you see angles, not because parallel walls are bad. Okay, so if we pile this stuff up and build up our first, second, and third harmonics, and then do it for all three dimensions, we can, for any room, see where the waves pile up. And the goal here is to distribute them as equally as possible. In this room, of course, they're not equally distributed. This is not a particularly good sounding room because we have dimensions equal to 12. Notice that they're piling up on each other. Okay? However, you can see the pileups right there. But look what happens, and this is key, this is critical. Look what happens when I display the frequency on a logarithmic scale, which is in fact how we hear. We hear on an octave base or closer to a logarithmic scale. Even this less than perfect room, the modes are just getting closer and closer, and they finally get so close that it's not a problem anymore. When we've hit that moment, we're at the Schroeder frequency, and we are now no longer in a modal condition, we're in a what's called statistical condition or more reverberation time-oriented condition, okay? So even bad rooms have a point where it doesn't really matter. As the rooms get bigger, that frequency gets lower. And as the rooms get, when they get so big, the frequency is so low that there's never any modal. That's what I was talking about before. That's why the smaller rooms are the hardest ones, because the Schroeder frequency is higher. The first eigentones start higher. Some of you were nodding already, maybe now a few more of you are nodding. So what do? We're just gonna change some dimensions. Notice now that the modes, we don't have any conflicting modes. This would lead you to believe that there's an infinite universe of well-proportioned rooms and an infinite universe of not-so-well-proportioned rooms. So there's two infinite universes, which of course brings us to a whole nother subject, which we won't continue. Okay, but there's a lot of different rooms, and there is no one perfect room. It's a long-standing debate. There's a family of good-sounding rooms, and you can use some math to figure it out. You could use that math, which of course nobody wants to use, okay? Which is not too bad, gets you right back to where we started. Or you could use these diagrams of acceptable room ratios, which actually are easy to use. And there's a few of them, this is one of them, been around for about 50 years, where if you just took, for instance, this room, divide by the height, plot the resultant width and length, you see that it's outside. Take our second room, divide by the height, get these odd numbers, plot, notice that it's in, and you can quickly check whether your room is going to be okay. Can we have rooms that are outside of this? Yes. Just means we have to work harder. It means we have to find the modes, okay? Attack the modes with low-frequency treatment. Low-frequency absorption is not foam. Low-frequency absorption is very deep traps or resonators or membranes, and we finally have entered the era of thin, prefabricated low-frequency absorption. It's for years this was the bane of our existence, but we now have companies making prefabricated membrane absorbers 4 inches and thinner. This is really, really good news for us, very good news for you. Second part of this talk, Josh is going to take you through an actual report that we did for the PreSonus rooms, and you'll actually see what that report looks like, and you'll see how we tackled and solved that. This would be very practical and applicable for people interested in small rooms that will have low frequency. So by the way of ending, somebody called one day into our office and said, I got this space in my basement, what should I do? It was a kind of a ridiculous phone call, and how they even got through was a whole nother story. Okay, what should I do? What should I do? And as ridiculous as the call was, I felt it might be interesting to answer the call. So I said, why don't you make a closet? Hoping he'd hang up. That did not work. He didn't hang up, but it was the right idea. What was bothering me the most was the 20 by 20. The 20 by 20 was a nightmare. I got to get rid of the 20 by 20. By making a closet, second tip, orient the room wide ways rather than deep ways. Here's a listening position, maybe a couch. You could put a console there. Why? Because the side walls, which are usually the walls that are going to get the first reflection, okay, that could cause a bounce in the listening position, are further to the side. Okay, and if you're wide enough, they won't bother you at all. And then just figure out maybe we need a little absorption there. You don't have to put absorption on the whole wall. Just put it right there. You need a $2 measuring piece of equipment. It's called a pocket mirror. You just put the mirror there. When you see the speaker sees you. Boom, put a little foam there. You're all done. And that, because that's the only place where there could be a nasty reflection. Okay, and then, you know, put a window there. Maybe put some treatment in the back. Maybe a combination absorbing, diffusing type treatment, depending on the distance. You're off to the races. You could make this room go from a 2 to a 7 for a few $1,000s. You're spending that on a microphone. That's the lesson here. This is a miracle. This is amazing. And why people don't do it, I don't know. Now, this doesn't solve electricity, air conditioning, isolation, big ticket items. But you always had those items. Those items always had to be solved, no matter what. But from an internal room acoustic issue, the notion of trying to get sound to sound better, uncolored, be more responsive, more exact, what goes in is what's coming out, it's not that much money to make a big improvement, okay? All right, so recording studios today, we've kind of gone from here through this. I went through this. We all went through this, okay, to get to this, which is the Time Warner Center in New York, which is an extraordinary, and right in there is a recording studio. It looks very small because the halls are actually quite big, and it is, in fact, that studio that we saw, okay, that are now personalized, beautiful, ergonomic, acoustically responsive, and hold amazing equipment, all costing less. Electric Lady Studios, okay, actually cost more 40-something years ago to build than this studio cost only a few years ago. So what can we look forward to? All right, then we're going to see some pictures. Prefabricated acoustic materials, very important. Okay, we've entered an amazing era. A lot of people have entered this marketplace. There's some charlatans, there's some misinformation. The web is responsible for that. But there's also a lot of good stuff on the market. Okay, a lot of good stuff. And so that means prices are going down. Low frequency control is what I'm the most interested in, because thin low frequency control is always very, very tricky. Most people are controlling sound or absorbing sound with trapped air. Can't do that. Low frequencies trapped air, you need a lot of space. But by using resonators or vibrating membranes or slots or perforated products, okay, we can now control low frequency very exactly. It's measurable, it's repeatable, relatively cheap. For us, thin is 4 inches or lower. Even in the isolation world, these two are the most exciting. Okay, we have democratic measuring systems. By that I mean everybody can have one. So we no longer have the witch doctor model. Throw that out, okay, which is essentially what was going on for the last few thousand years. Now everybody can measure their own, measure everything, and so everything is much more democratic, and we have prediction software. This is the fun, and we use, Jesus Christ, sorry. Well, that was, do me a favor. See if it's an emergency, just see if it's an emergency, will you? Yeah. It's one of my kids. It's the only, I get scared when they call. Okay, especially the oldest one. Anybody got any daughters here? Sons are much easier. They get older and then they just become your friends. The girls, well, clearly I have some allies here. Okay, it goes on forever. Okay, but I love them, you know. It's just anyway, so that scares me when I, and she knows I'm here too. So the prediction software. Okay, so what's this going to look like? Maybe we can expect these kinds of headlines, that we can really predict what our rooms are going to sound like, because that's exciting. This headline, though, you cannot look forward to, because this already happened, okay, a long time ago. This was the headline in the New York Times when Wallace Sabine, who tooled around for a few years in Boston, who kind of created, first was the person that put the algorithms together for the reverberation time equations, really finally figured out at least his interpretation of the relationship between volume, surface treatments, and reverberation time, which is in effect one of the main ways that we put an acoustic signature on a space. And it was very exciting. But we can listen to rooms now from drawings. We can actually predict specifications and listen. Actually listen to rooms from drawings. This is very exciting. Okay, let's look at an example. Here's a church in Western Switzerland. Okay, kind of exciting. Looks a little bit like the Corbusier Ronchamp Chapel. That's actually not that far away, really. And let's take a look at the inside of this church. So what do you think this sounds like? There's not an absorptive surface in this place. This is just the concrete, rock, stone, wood. Even the altar is terrazzo. Two crappy high school speakers there. The acoustic information is a man speaking. That's what goes on every Sunday, okay, is a man speaking. So what's this going to sound like? Well, let's take a look. That's what it sounds like. Now, everyone in this room probably can get a feel for what this sounds like from this graph. This is not 0.7. That's 7. Not 0.7. That's 7 seconds. Yes, it had a 7-second reverb time at 500 hertz. That's crazy. Well, let's listen to it. That's what we measured. Let's listen to this. Might be a little loud.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
One of those test files that has all the consonants and vowels. You've heard that, okay? That is, in fact, exactly what it sounded like. It's just awful. I'm amazed that anybody could hear anything. And in fact, they couldn't. So this little town got some money together. They sought us out. And what we did was we oralized the space. I'll come back to this graph in a minute. Okay, by that I mean we modeled the space in a kind of a 3D program. And it sort of looks like a photorealistic 3D, but it's not photorealistic. We're making as many surfaces as we have to, no more than we have to, so that we can assign values to each surface with respect to scattering and absorption. Sounds hard, well, it actually is hard to do, but we have a lot of this information now. But in this case, it was tricky because what's the absorption of that stone? What's the diffusion of that stone? We kind of had to guess. So what we did was we did all this, and we kept fooling around and kind of twiddling around with the surfaces, okay, until we finally got the measured response, the recorded response, which you just heard, and the oralized response to sound the same. So what does that mean? Once we get this model, if we put a send source and a receive position through, we can actually get the impulse response. So what are you measuring in a space? When we come in here to measure this space, we measure the impulse response, which is sort of that something that looks like that waterfall diagram. It's the story of all frequencies over a certain amount of time and how they behave. Well, we can actually get it. Is there an emergency? No, okay, good. Okay, oh, good. Did you tell her she was the joke of the session? No, okay. She would love that, actually. She likes attention. So we can calculate the impulse response because we have the send position, we have the receive position, and we have all the characteristics of all the surfaces. Once we have that, we could reverse the process, send sound through this model, and actually listen to it. This is what oralization is. I've kind of oversimplified it. There's a few pieces of on-the-market software that do this, about three of them. We've looked at all three. We use one called CATT, C-A-T-T, Acoustic. Ease does it. Odeon does it. There's a few other proprietary ones. They do it in slightly different ways, mostly ray tracing, okay? But making the model is the trick. That's the time-consuming part. The model has to be right. If the model's no good, nothing works. Once we got it baselined, now we can start changing the surfaces and we can just listen to it. So, in fact, that guy right there.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a a small set of letters.
We kept adjusting the model until both of them were the same. Then we went in for a kind of a pre-presentation, almost presentation marketing meeting. We did it twice. This is with headphones, so it all sounded very much more accurate than this. And they said, you got that from a drawing? And of course, that we got the project, but we also got the tool. Then we figure out, what's the goal curve? Well, a computer doesn't do this. This is what designers do or experience. Obviously, we wanted to lower it. The lower the reverberation, the better, the more the STI, the more the intelligibility. And we wanted to flatten it out a little bit. We kind of cheated a little bit because it wasn't, I mean, when you walked in the space, there was only one place you could do any work, and that's the ceiling. They're not going to let us touch anything else. The ceiling is concrete with these wood slots. So in 10 seconds, we knew what we had to do. It just took 6 months to prove it. Okay, sometimes, well, you know, not our fault we knew what to do. It was their fault they didn't know what to do. So, you know, we knew we were going to have to take down the wood, throw up the insulation, and put the wood back, the wood slots, okay, these Scandinavian-style slots, adding absorption. But it was good to, but how much? And how much air should we put in between the insulation? Because that's going to change the characteristic of the insulation. So this is an extraordinary tool. We don't really use it as a marketing tool anymore. Now we really use it to find out what things are going to sound like, okay? And then, so when we finally got it right, because imagine going into a five-person building committee in Western Switzerland with this graph. This doesn't mean anything, this graph. In this room, this graph means something. Now, oh yeah, you know what? It is going to sound better. Well, let's go listen. Okay, so now you can already hear that it's going to sound better.
In language, infinitely many words can be written with a small set of letters.
And it sounds better. You can start to hear everything. Still has a little God in it. Okay. Quite frankly, if we could have put more absorption in the room, I'm not sure if we would have. It sounded just okay. And we've had that situation. That's enough. In fact, usually our battle is not how much absorption we can put in. Usually the battle is how little absorption we can put in. It's usually exactly the opposite. Okay. And then, of course, now we go do the work. That's exactly what it looked like. We took down all the top. Put up very cheap black insulation because it was more or less going to get covered with the slots and there's no lighting on it, and got the results. And our results were almost right on spot on the money. The accuracy of these prediction programs are incredible. We're using this on most of our important projects now, or we're certainly using it on projects where we ourselves are not 100% sure where things are going to land. Very valuable design tools, the oralization. Of course, it spits out the reverberation time on an octave basis, spits out other kinds of information. We can get STI out of it. We can get coverage out of it. So sometimes coverage, for instance, in stadiums, it's all about coverage. Last week at the AAS, we gave papers on our stadiums. It's not too much about reverb. It's about coverage. Okay, so we get lots of information out of these programs. Okay? All right, studio construction. I'm going to skip over this. I got to make a leap here. What we're missing is a big studio we built in China, which is actually a personalized studio. And they're just going to skip it. Anyone that's interested in it, okay. And this is really where I want to go. And this everything's been a prelude to really the pictures, the photos, the studios, because I think, and we were talking about this earlier, the studio business is anything but dead. In fact, it's more vibrant than ever. I'm 67 years old. In my wildest dreams, I never thought we would be this busy. We're busier than I've ever been in my life. Some of it is because we're here a long time. But I believe it's because there are, in fact, more studios being built than ever before. Okay? What changes the business model? Okay, the business model is not changing, it's changed. It changed 10 years ago, 15 years ago. Okay, took a little while, it's a little bit wrinkly, there's still things being ironed out, and depending on what article you read, downloads are up, downloads are down, and you want to get into the Spotify versus Pandora debate, and there's a lot of stuff that's got to be wrinkled out, but on the long-term picture, 10, 15 years from now, we're going to look back, and it's all going to be a blur, and it's all going to be really good, just like the Bob Marley song. So we're going to get this new model, and it's going to be more democratic. Anybody can make a record. Anybody can get it out there. Anybody can put 500 copies out, and you can actually make money from it. Okay? So where's all this stuff going to be done? It's got to be done in studios of some sort. Okay, and the physics didn't change. These acoustic principles didn't change. They're not changing at all. As a matter of fact, I believe there's more and more of a demand. And if you believe Massenburg's Heiser lecture from last week in, at the AES, there's even more pent-up demand for production values to be better. Growth of vinyl, okay? Better records sound better through those crappy iPods than shitty records, even though the little buds are just disgusting. It's just depressing how bad the delivery system is. But we all know that better produced records actually sound better. They just do, okay? And it's certainly the mantra of where we are today in the company that's hosting this. We know that, and other companies too, okay? So what's changed? The business model changed. And this notion of the project studio, as we said, little did I know that my first, quote, commercial studio was in fact the project studio. It was the penultimate project studio for the penultimate artist. I just had no idea I was doing it. And now we're in the era where every studio is a project studio or a personalized studio. Even the commercial studios are highly personalized. It's the only reason why they have commercial value, okay? Why the art, the music, and the media has taken control. Completely, it is no longer being run by a very small amount of music business people or even by the equipment people. For a while, our industry was being driven by the equipment people. That is not the case anymore. Now, there's a much more balanced arrangement between artists, designers, producers, engineers, equipment people, architects, acousticians, real estate people, all much more level, much more balanced. Everybody recognizing that everything that they all, we all have to sort of live together in this effort, okay, to have great music being made in great environments, okay? So we get this kind of, we're just gonna race through the, I'm gonna get more specific. What's common about all these studios? Nothing is common about all these studios. That's in a church, that's a studio in a church. Here's a guy who bought a church to put his studio in it. There's a fantastic studio in Utica, New York. So what's common about all those studios? Absolutely nothing other than we did them. Why? Because every single one had a different personality, different use, different purpose, different agenda, but they all are personalized studios that kind of are straddling the line between personal studios and commercial studios, okay? Every single one of those has a commercial agenda. There is a money agenda. Certainly there was money to build them. None of them were terribly expensive, by the way. And without a doubt, the most expensive component was the isolation, okay? For instance, let's go back to maybe the biggest one, which was this church studio, okay? I mean, the first question was, how are we going to isolate this church from the rest of the world? Because, well, okay. And in the end, we said, we're not. That was quick. That was an easy budget decision. What are we going to do? We're going to take the six windows. They had some glass windows. We're going to close them up, fix a few doors. So they spent $5,000, and that's it. Well, what about a driving thunderstorm? We'll just stop the session. We'll give them another day. It's happened 3 times in 8 years. Okay? That was a quick $500,000 decision. Social solution, because it was impossible. How would you do it? Well, you either kill all this or put a big bubble on the outside of the, either way, it was an easy solution, but it was a social solution. Okay, what we did do though was completely isolate the two oversized sound locks, which are actually vocal booths, and the control room. And you can even see, you can just sort of see it from here. There's the control room looking in. It's a room within a room, 3 rooms within rooms, all separate. They're actually lid construction, so they're boxes in boxes, okay? So all three of those are isolated from each other. Actually, this is a studio right here. This is a project studio. There are many studios that's a big studio, okay, with 2 vocal booths, okay? One was on the cover of Mix Magazine a few months ago. We'll take a look at it, with a giant church attached to it, so you could look at it a different way, okay? So what did we do? We just sort of looked at the project from a different lens, okay, and boom, there goes that 500 grand, okay? But we did isolate these guys, split slabs, actually not split slabs, but lid construction. By that I mean walls go up, lids go over and come down, no springs, always the best if you can do it. You need height, and you need height, and the rooms can't be much bigger than this, much bigger than you can't, the spans are too big. Always the cheapest and easiest way to build. And we're off to the races, and he's only lost, I think he's lost two or three sessions over the life of the studio, and you still get to preserve the extraordinary sound of the church, okay? Whereas this studio is highly isolated. There it is on a noisy street in the Bronx associated with a church. It's the private studio of a church, so it's the personal studio associated with the church, but it got so successful that it actually became a commercial studio. So the word got out that there was a studio in the East Bronx, and it's right on a main street. Okay, so we had to highly isolate this room in order to keep the street noise out. Okay, so everyone different, everyone reacting to different personal conditions. Let's continue as long as we have time to just look at studios. Small, what I call, this is actually a studio inside an ad agency, but it's really one person's studio, very small. Okay, notice how everything fits in. Again, no front glass in this case, but it has an oversized vocal booth. Take a look at the detail. Symmetry, you're going to see that in every studio. Okay, here, slight non-parallel walls just to make sure we don't have any nasty reflections. The idea is to try to make sure that this speaker doesn't pop a reflection here coming maybe 3, 4, 5 feet later than the direct. That's really, it's called an initial time delay gap. You want to get that reflection-free zone free of initial time delay secondary reflections. That's maybe the most important single design thing, one of the most important single design issues. We check that all the time right away. Sometimes we can get it, a way that we often do it is by angling that wall, but it's not because parallel walls are bad. Symmetry is important, okay? Glass slider here equals that wall on the other side. Doesn't mean we have to have glass, it just means we have to have a surface that's behaving the same. And that's what it looks like, okay? This could easily be somebody's private project studio. It basically is, it's just inside an advertising agency, okay? You'll see a lot of projects now that you're gonna see a lot of studios with clouds. We do this a lot. Usually the Z dimension or the height dimension is usually the troubling dimension. We usually are not given enough height. Okay, why? Buildings just don't seem to come with as much height as we want. Okay, and when we do the modal calculations, we often see that the height is the problem. Okay, the height is what's causing the modal misdistribution, which means we have to put targeted, thin, low-frequency absorption in the listener's plane in the Z direction. Everybody following me? Well, where are you going to do that? Well, you're not going to stand on it. So I'm going to want to do it up there. But up there is usually where other things happen, like lights and air conditioning and things like that, and usually I don't have enough height. So thank goodness we have thin membrane absorption. You'll see this in a number of instances. So we usually hide it with clouds. Sometimes the clouds themselves are the membrane absorption. If we have a lot of height, we can actually build a cloud that is a membrane absorber. Depends. Okay, we can also then use that to mask our air conditioning and hold our lighting. So it's a kind of a common trick that we use a few times, and we've kind of gotten, I guess it's become a little bit of a signature for us. We're happy with it, and we use it to have architectural fun. We're supposed to have fun in these rooms. That's the whole point. That's why they're personal, is because they're fun. When they don't become fun, there's no reason to do it anymore. This is actually shouldn't even be there. So here's one that has a lot of fun. This is in Italy, through a courtyard, up a stair, kitchen, everything's about the food in Italy, up some more stairs, and then two studios sharing two overdub ISO Foley rooms with Foley pits, and a third room that can even talk to these rooms. All these rooms can operate at the same time. Now, very cool in plan, but very difficult to do. Usually, to do that, you need tremendous isolation. It's tricky, but it was worth doing here because the real estate is so expensive. Okay, blow-up diagram of that, and look how this is taking place on the upper floor of this kind of industrial-type building. We popped up to get a skylight, and the daylight comes in over the room into the public area, the corridor, okay, down into this area, but also through a skylight. You wouldn't exactly start off with a skylight over your listening position, but that's what they wanted. They do most of their work during the day, and they just didn't want to work in a dark, dingy thing. But it turned out to not be that big a deal. A small angle on the glass diverted the sound into this big cavity, which also held the projector, so it wasn't that big a deal. Room's a little bit longer than we wanted it. That's just, that was an ergonomic thing. Our modes would have been better if it was a little bit, not quite so long, but we solved it. Okay, and you'd expect these colors in Italy, that's for sure. Okay, no console. First major studio I did with no console, no controller, no nothing. Now, of course, quite common. When I asked them, they said, we could work faster without a console. They just didn't need a console. It was, of course, there wasn't an engineer over 24 in the place, but that's what makes it fun. Lots of different styles, lots of different ways of recording. It's very cool. Okay, great. You can see how complex these walls are. To get this level of isolation between all these rooms, these are all triple wide walls and very exacting and very detailed. You'll see a triple wall detail, I think it's in the photo, that in PreSonus we needed a triple wall detail on one of our environments. Yeah, very cool. Now this is a very large studio, but is a project studio built in the mountaintop near Woodstock, New York, overlooking the Shokan Reservoir, just closed last year, unfortunately. It's basically a project studio, kind of like Electric Lady is a project studio. It's built by one guy for his personal use, and then he allowed groups to come in there a month at a time. I still think one of the more amazing ones that we ever did. Big, it was a summer home for some very wealthy people in the 20s, very big summer home. And in this room right here is where we added this room, that little guy right there is this. You can see how big the whole house is. And we added the control room looking into this big room. It was the great room that we chased. Piano sound is amazing in this room. Why? Because the walls were very thin. There's a summer house. So the walls were very thin. So when I first measured the room, you would expect the low frequency reverb time to just keep rising and rising because there's no low frequency absorption. But it didn't. It actually tailed off a little bit, which we know from experience in live rooms is actually preferred in recording studios. And I said, why is this happening? And the bulb went off pretty quick. It went off because these walls are very thin. So this low-frequency energy was going out. On the other hand, if they're going to use this for world-class recording, like Dave Matthews or those kinds of people, we're going to have to isolate this room. We can't be having wind and rain. It's actually noisy up there on the top of the mountain. So literally, unlike that church I showed you, we built the building literally around this building that was 12 inches thick. We literally duplicated the building 12 inches thick around the building. Same roofing, same siding. Nobody, when it was all done, you wouldn't have even noticed, except where the chimney was, because it was, instead of sticking out, it was flush. And we had to leave a 6-inch airspace. If I don't leave that airspace, then I don't get the wood that's inside the studio to be membranic, and I change the low frequency characteristic completely. I now have a stiff wall, low frequency absorption completely changes, piano sound is completely shot. It would cost $250,000 to isolate that room before we even started thinking about a studio. But the owner wanted that, he was passionate and dedicated to it. And that's the sunroom or the drum room, and that's not Photoshop. You can see sort of the magic of the place. So we're always gonna need these kinds of, this is the extreme. This is one whole extreme of a project personal studio. Money's no object. Let's go to the other extreme, which we will. Okay? Two songwriters, their personal studios. Okay, first question I asked, they went songwriter, two of them, and they want to have like a common recording room for strings. They do a lot of film music. And my first question was, do you have to look forward? It's always my first question. One guy said absolutely, and the other guy said I don't care, which means no to me. So we made that the surround room, okay, and put his viewing window here, symmetrical window door over here. His partner looked forward. Okay, into a common room. Again, they normally work separately. Triple wall system, masonry on the inside, sheetrock separated on the outside, and you get these kinds of rooms. It's completely the other end of the spectrum. Very affordable. Again, a cloud, and the cloud can be circular. We have a lot of fun with the shapes of these clouds. Circular, elliptical, grids, lines, sometimes wood fins. We can have fun with them. We can just have fun with them. This is Green Day's studio. This is their personal project studio. Here we had plenty of height at 880s in Oakland. And so the cloud itself is membranic, is the membrane absorber. That's what's controlling the low frequency in this room. Sometimes we have more than enough height. The guitar player, he turned to me, he says, you think we can, I got all these curtains, you think we can use the curtains? I'm not a big fan of curtains, kind of goofy kind. But you know, it's Green Day. You want curtains? Curtains, it's exactly what I was thinking of. It was exactly what I was not thinking of, but it's his studio. It's not my studio, it's his studio. Curtains, fine, let's put the curtains up and then we'll work backwards. So once I got all those curtains in, I don't need any more absorption, I need some reflection. Hello? Put it on a big angle, make it membranic, low frequency absorber, high frequency scatterer, big diffuser in the back. That's what he wanted. So what, how we got a few more minutes? What? Yeah, we go. The Jay-Z studio. That's a membrane absorber right there that when we put it up and we were going to cover it, okay, they came in, they said, we like the look of it, so we just left it there. That's a membrane absorber from Europe. Tim Mosley's studio, big Augsburger system. Fito Paez from Argentina, his personal studio. You saw that picture earlier. Variable Acoustics. Carter Burwell, who writes Hollywood film for the Coen brothers, his personal studio on the upper floor of a Tribeca loft. Okay, off the elevator, his living. Okay, wider than deeper control room. Small vocal booth. Two positions, mix position and composing position. Okay, we sort of struggled with this, and in the end, it was that simple. Two sets of monitors, composing and mixing. There's his composing position. One of Alicia Keys' original studios, first AWS in New York, wider than deeper. The trick here is this surface. That surface is all membranic, okay? Thin plywood. When it's covered, it just looks like fabric, but it's not insulation. If I put it in insulation, it's not gonna work. It's gonna be dead at mids and highs, but it's not gonna be membranic. In a garage, the CNC music, you remember CNC music, one of the C's died, one of them didn't. This is the one that didn't. In the garage, didn't want to go to New York anymore, so we built the studio in his garage, called it the Paradise Garage Studio. We have a few more. So this is for Cynthia Daniels, this Grammy Award-winning engineer. In addition to her house in East Hampton, this is now thus the only studio in East Hampton, and now at a world-class level, and it's right there. So this looks like a wood, it is a wood addition to a typical Hamptons wood house, but it's sand-filled 12-inch block once again. Okay, that's the solution. Then we just covered it with wood to look like wood. That's all that she needed. There's the diagram. Two vocal booths on either side. She really needed one. We wanted two because we wanted the glass. Best thing she ever did. Now she can actually record groups there, and that's what that room looks like. We got on the Mix magazine a few months ago. They're double sliders from a company in Utah, SBW. I believe now we think they make the best slider right now, soundproof windows out of in the United States. Yeah, but we use two of them. There was no room for sound locks and whatnot. Okay, so we got to wrap this up. We're missing a lot. Anybody that wants to fool with this, with me, just see me some more, and we're going to go for the last. So this is what I want to try to have you leave with, okay? We work up every day, and I make no distinction, our group makes no distinction, our team, between architecture and acoustics. It's the same thing. We don't think in terms of architecture, and then we paint on the acoustics. They're the same thing. Maybe for 30 minutes we spent all of our time talking about acoustics, but in reality, when we start thinking about how these things get shaped, sometimes it's ergonomics, sometimes we're paying attention to a door swing, a window view, Billy Joe's desire to have curtains. We're doing a studio for Nate Hill now, Danger, and they want two big fish tanks in the studio. Two giant fish tanks in the studio. Are you kidding me? Okay, what, I mean, Jesus, you know, so, you know, you don't know what's going to be thrown at you. That's what's the fun about it. You got to, okay? They're personalized. The two are going to grow to love each other more and more because we are now no longer thinking about being in the era of personalized project studios. We are in the era, the most democratic era ever of personalized project studios. And for me, I didn't even know it, but I was always in that era. Jimi, God bless you, gave me that. It took 25 years before I ever went back into the studio and 35 years before they had a little commemorative thing before I even realized it. So as we thank him for the music, I thank him for something other than the music. And my last three slides are all the same. Keep following your dreams. So in this room, okay, that would appear to be a very amazing concert chamber hall type orchestra style room. Look at all the wood and glass and angles and whatnot. You could just imagine strings sounding really good. Not. This is a speech auditorium for a pharmaceutical company. No music, zero music. This is a dead room. High STI, high speech intelligibility index, okay? But the architect, if you're Frank Gehry, he wants all these surfaces. Where are the acousticians? We gotta figure it out. How are we doing it? All perforated and slotted wood, semi-perforated glass, angles, lots of air, treatments above the glass, et cetera, et cetera. So we no longer have to be limited by our traditional approaches to acoustics. Make the room dead with foam or curtains. If we don't want that, it's going to be bright. Parallel walls are bad. All this stuff, throw all of it out. We can almost do anything we want. Want a flat, perfectly flat, glossy, white plaster ceiling? It can be 100% absorptive. Three companies now, not one, three companies make absorptive plaster. I mean, perfectly absorptive. They're more absorptive than the curtain, but it's plaster and you can knock on it if you want that. Okay? Follow your dreams. And so, of course, at Jazz at Lincoln Center in the Allen Room, you probably wouldn't start off with a big giant piece of glass behind your stage. That's not the starting point to design a stage, at least intuitively. But when you're looking over a $1 billion view from the sixth floor into Central Park, that's what you're starting off with. It turns out to not be that wasn't that complicated. We needed two pieces of glass. We angle the inner glass up, not tilting down like we so often do. The back energy from the stage hits the glass, goes up into the acoustically transparent ceiling, which is really a bunch of tubes with tubes every 8 inches, goes through the ceiling, the swooping aeroserenin shape designed very nicely by Raphael Vignoli, the project architect, goes up into the catwalks and the infrastructure where there's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of 2-foot by 2-foot RPG skyline diffusers painted black. The same diffusers that many of you have touched and you've seen in studio. Very cheap, glued up to the underside of the ductwork and catwalks. So the sound goes up, hits the diffusers, comes raining down like rain, stays in the room, reverberation time stays high, no bad reflections. So what looked like something that was just gonna catch us off guard here with this big piece of glass turns out to be a true asset to the sound. And as our final two slides, okay, we show you this. This is the last slide you're all sitting there saying, what's going on here? Okay, so what is this? This was a room we did a number of years ago, maybe 10 or 12 years ago, in Argentina. What was significant? It was the first time in Argentina where somebody tried to install a surround sound control room and also have a studio. They don't have a distinct business of surround rooms and recording rooms. Everybody has to be everything. So very nice studio. Actually, this is a cool studio with all these variable acoustic doors and ceilings that turn on motors and stuff. But the control room, which was a shape we were pretty familiar with, to make it surround, what we did was design the control room and then put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 speakers exactly where I wanted them, ITU specs, 30 degrees off, 115 back, actually about 125 back degrees, ear level. And then connected them all with glass, making an infinite baffle, because we all know that if we baffle speakers, we're going to change the speaker boundary interference. We're going to improve the speaker boundary interference, and I'm not going to have the rear radiation. So my dream was is that it would sort of look like one glass wall with some speakers in it. And that was the vision. Okay, we'll just have the glass wall with speakers. Well, that's not exactly what happened. As it turns, well, they didn't install the middle speaker in this picture. They ultimately did. What turned out was the wall between the speaker and the glass got too thick during construction, and then there's all this thickness with the trim, and it just ended up not really being like the dream. It sort of looked better in drawings than it did in reality, and so it ended up being four little windows with the speakers in the right place. And I never forgot that. And when I went back there, I said, no, that's not what we really envisioned. What we really wanted, why can't we get this wall thinner? Why can't we squeeze it? Why, maybe it's just a thin piece of metal. Maybe it's 1-inch metal. Or maybe the glass is the speaker. Yeah, that's not gonna work, okay? Not a bad idea, but not today anyway. And finally, we gotta be able to put the speaker in the glass, and we finally got a shot at it. We finally were able to actually put the speaker in the glass. The trick is that the glass that the speakers were in have nothing to do with the isolation. That was the trick. That was the lesson that we learned. You have to kind of get out of the box to think about the problem. Don't just forget about that glass. Make the studio and then put a whole nother set of glass in front of it that holds the speaker. We finally got a chance to do it. It was a religious recording company in Brazil. Now you figured it would be somebody who asked God whether we knew how to do it, since we had to say we had never done it. And we finally did get a chance to do it. And that is my last slide. You need to keep on following your dreams. And this was the dream. It took about 8 years before we finally did get to do it. We've done it twice more. We did it in a small studio in Syracuse, and we did it for Jungle Studios, which many of you are familiar with, Tech Award-winning studio in New York, and with the larger Augsburgers. But using these Genelec 1038s, you really do get the impression that the speakers are really floating in the glass. And after a while, when you sit there, there's really no more speakers. It's just all glass, yet there are the speakers at exactly ear level, which is where we always want them, no reflections. Room is wider than it is deeper. And a few other tricks. Can't tell you every trick, okay? But we finally did get our chance to follow our dreams. That's the Jungle Studios that we finally got to do it again in. And my last slide, a personal thanks to Jimi for changing my life. I had no idea exactly how he was changing it when I first met him, but he's still with me, he's still with us. I still love his music. And a personal thanks to you for sticking out a few extra minutes.
And thanks to John Storyk.